is a sacred commitment, a promise to leave no soldier behind.
Well, to me, honoring a commitment means you fulfill your word. Pure and simple, you simply, if you say you're going to do it, well, you do it. I think that you measure a society to a large extent based on how they respect and treat their dead. And I can't think of a higher honor for someone who's given their life fighting for their country than to actually make the effort to identify their remains, recover them, and have them properly buried with the family.
One of the things that we have to understand as citizens, and when we do something like returning a missing family member, is that all of those individual soldiers and sailors, airmen, men and women who served from World War II forward, each of those individual losses is a private trauma on the hand of the family's loss, but it is a collective societal trauma as well.
In 2006, former U.S. Army Major Charles Ray was appointed as the Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for POW and Missing Personnel Affairs.
Because that person came forward when his country called and paid the ultimate sacrifice, and if a country can afford to send people off to war, it can damn well afford to try and bring them back again dead or alive. I mean, that's just my view. If you can't afford to bring them back, you can't afford to send them in the first place. We owe that much to the people who we sent to fight on behalf of this country.
Dr. Pauline Boss is a retired professor from the University of Minnesota.
For my entire academic career, my focus has been on what I call ambiguous loss. That is, where someone is missing physically or psychologically. Ambiguous loss can last a lifetime and, in fact, across generations. We learned that from the Holocaust, for example, where loved ones were taken away to concentration camps and the families left behind, and the relatives' subsequent generations didn't know if they were dead or alive somewhere because they had no proof of death. This is also true with soldiers who have gone missing. Much of the research, for example, on the Vietnam pilots who went missing is being done by subsequent generations, daughters, granddaughters, sons, grandsons, who still are troubled by the ambiguous loss that they saw their mothers suffer from, their parents suffer from.
I was named after my uncle, Lawrence, and to me that imposes an obligation. And it's probably a self-imposed obligation, but I still feel a commitment to the family, and it started out by my making a commitment to my father, but it's become something much bigger than that. To me, it's the whole concept of not letting his life be forgotten.
Lawrence R. Gordon is a married father of two. He lives in Medicine Hat, Alberta, where he has practiced law for over 40 years.
My full name is Lawrence Robert Gordon. I was named after my uncle, Lawrence Samuel Gordon, who was killed on August 13, 1944 at the Battle of the Falaise Gap in France.
Lawrence Samuel Gordon was born on June 26, 1916 in East End, Saskatchewan, Canada, to Sam and Ella Gordon. He was the fourth of five children.
When you're trying to determine what a relative was like, such as my Uncle Lawrence, you don't have a lot of information to work with.
My dad told me he was a guy that always had money, even in hard times as young guys. His two other brothers was always broke, and Uncle Lawrence always had a car, always had money, always had a job, and he'd come up and help my dad harvest, and my dad just loved to work with him.
As a young man, Lawrence Samuel Gordon came to maturity during the Great Depression. With work short at home, he left his native Canada and moved to Wyoming, where he found a job on a sheep ranch near Casper, Wyoming. But fate and war would soon take him even farther from home.
Dateline, Pearl Harbor, December 7th, 1941. At 7:55 came the most treacherous attack in the history of modern warfare. Pearl Harbor was blasted by a sneak raid of over 100 Japanese planes.
My Uncle Lawrence was born in Canada, so he was a Canadian citizen, but his father and mother were both American citizens, and he had gone back to the United States to work. And at the time, he decided to join the U.S. Army, largely because he felt it was better equipped. He was going to join an army, and the three brothers had talked. One of them decided to join the Canadian Army. The other two chose the U.S. Army. When you're younger, it's your name, you learn about your uncle that you were named after, and as you get a little bit older, you become curious about it. And I'm talking even at the age of 7, 8, 9, you become curious. It's where did my name come from? Why am I named after this person? Why have I never met him? And of course, you learn that he had been killed in the war, and then you start to develop an interest in, it's like a big mystery. You develop this interest in a person that you're never going to meet. My father, being a farmer from East End, Saskatchewan, but born in southern Illinois, had never traveled to Europe in his life. During his lifetime, that wasn't an easy thing to do. And communication was restricted, so he never knew where Uncle Lawrence was interred. He thought that he was interred somewhere in a military cemetery in Europe. He didn't know where, he just wished he did. And he wanted someone to find out where he was and go there.
50 years after receiving his uncle's name, Lawrence Gordon traveled to Europe to honor the commitment that he made to his father, or so he thought.
In preparation for the trip there, I had written to the U.S. Army asking for the location of the grave for my uncle Lawrence S. Gordon. And I had been told that it was at St. James in Normandy. When I got to St. James, I discovered there was no grave, that in fact there hadn't been a recovered body, and there was his name carved into their wall of honor.
For Lawrence Gordon, it was hard to come to terms that there was no body and no grave, just his uncle's name on a wall. The problem was the burned and blood-stained wallet that was returned to his family in the 1940s.
This is where I keep the wallet that I received from my father. It's burned, as you can see. There are stains on it, which from the records indicate that probably those were blood stains. I guess that it's a question of assumptions. I assumed from the wallet and the condition of the wallet that there was a grave. I just didn't know where it was. When I wrote to the U.S. Army, they didn't tell me there wasn't a grave.
But then, in 2012, a newfound hope. Lawrence was contacted at his law office by a group of researchers who said they had new information about the death of his uncle.
So this is the house where Uncle Lawrence was born and raised, and the pictures that were in his wallet were taken right on that front step.
My Uncle Lawrence, at the time of his death, was carrying a wallet, and I believe, as most farmers, that he was carrying the wallet in his rear left pocket. The wallet was returned to my grandmother, to Uncle Lawrence's mom, and in turn was passed to my father and subsequently to me. The wallet is interesting. It's burned, but not terribly. It has three pictures in it. The three pictures were taken in front of the farmhouse where my Uncle Lawrence had grown up. One of them is with his mother and my three older siblings, and two of them have his girlfriend Nancy in them with him. And those came to me from my father along with the Purple Heart that was awarded. What's interesting about the wallet is that there isn't one written bit of identification in it that indicates that it was Lawrence S. Gordon's wallet. There is no address in it, nothing in writing, but they managed to get the wallet back to the family.
The wallet is one of the central mysteries of PFC Gordon's story. How could his blood-stained wallet be recovered, inventoried, and returned to his family in Saskatchewan just months after the end of World War II, and the body it was taken from lost? For those closest to him, like his mother, being able to touch and hold the wallet without knowing his ultimate fate just intensified their grief. For PFC Gordon's girlfriend, now in her 80s and living in a nursing home in Ontario, the feeling is a little different, even after all these years. During our interview, she got to see the wallet for the first time.
Oh, no. Oh, God love his heart. Oh, look. See? There he is with me. And I guess this was taken just before he was sent overseas. I cried when he had to go overseas, and he was teared up too. He cried, but he says, "Don't worry, honey, I'll be back. I'll be back."
After joining the U.S. Army on January 24, 1942, Lawrence trained for a year and a half in the United States and was then sent to England to prepare for the invasion of France. On June 23, 1944, PFC Lawrence Gordon and his unit arrived on Omaha Beach. He and his comrades would soon be thrust into one of the most important battles in Europe.
We knew we were going to be in a combat. I mean, after all, that's what we were trained for. We had the vehicles, we had the skills that we were trained for, and it was scary because none of us had any idea what combat was actually like. But we knew there was danger and that some of us were going to come back. But it was still part of the adventure. You know, when you're young, you don't look on the dark side of things. You figure, well, if it's my turn, I'll be gone. And if it's not, I'll survive. So that's how we try to look at it.
Well, it was dangerous because we were at risk all the time. We were traveling through a country we didn't know. There were all sorts of places we were seeking an enemy that wanted to shoot us, and we didn't know where he was. We didn't know whether he was a mile away or 15 miles away. So you had to be watchful from the first moment on.
Late in the afternoon of August 13th, 1944, the armored car commanded by PFC Gordon was given a mission that would change the lives of three families forever. This passage is from a letter written by Private Charles Kurtz, the only surviving member of the vehicle.
Moved out of Rains on Black Road, past one intersection, 3 to 4 Spearhead Division units ahead and more behind. Lieutenant in armored car ahead of us called me by radio and ordered us to back up to intersection and fire on German motorcycle rider that passed us. I heard turn around. It was never fired. a German 88 was positioned on the left side of intersection Hiddeson gas tank. Two men and turret burned up.
PFC Lawrence Gordon and Private James Bowman from Kentucky were the men in the turret who were killed instantly. By the time their remains were discovered, no one was sure who they were. Their bodies were so badly disfigured and their uniforms so charred, it was even hard to identify them as American soldiers. After the war, soldiers from PFC Gordon's unit went to Canada to talk to his mother about what happened on August 13th.
Said that he was in a cafe, come out, and two guys, both had come to see my grandmother. He come out of the cafe, they got in a reconnaissance vehicle, and he was shot with some kind of a gun that blew it up right there. And they was standing around the corner watching. And they said, they told my grandmother that nothing we could do.
For Lawrence's girlfriend, Nancy, she always wondered what might have been.
If he had to come back, I think we would have been married. I knew he loved me. We had a lot of fun and everything dancing, but I never, ever would expect him to carry these with him. God love his heart, and you could tell he was burnt. Yeah, I knew that he felt the, you know, I thought we had a lot of fun. He liked me because I was a good dancer. But he must have really cared for me. This proves that he really did.
For the Gordon family, clues about the whereabouts of their lost uncle would begin to surface in decades-old military records that they didn't even know existed until 2012. The most promising document came from the deceased personnel file for Private James Bowman.
When I learned that the gunner, James Bowman, who was next to my uncle in the turret in the M8 Greyhound, had been identified, it was thrilling, to be quite direct about it.
But for PFC Gordon's family, the question was, how could one man from the turret be identified in 1945 and not the other? How did Lawrence Gordon's burned and blood-stained wallet make it back to Canada? Where was his body? To find the answers, the family dug deeper into the old military records and found that Private James Bowman from Kentucky had originally been buried as an American unknown soldier at a U.S. temporary cemetery near Grand, France. His remains were originally buried 2 days after being killed, and they were assigned an X number, which meant unknown. For the next 7.5 months, the remains were referred to as Grand Cemetery Unknown X2. Until the FBI matched the fingerprints of X2 to the fingerprints of Private Bowman. This is where the breakthrough for the Gordon family came nearly 70 years later. Records showed that when James Bowman's remains were collected, they also recovered the remains of another unknown soldier known as Garon X3. Retired Commander Rene Richardson used to research cases just like this for the U.S. government's Defense Prisoner of War Missing Personnel Office.
So you have the two individuals who get recovered and they get buried. They're buried as unknowns. After the group that initially buried them rolls out and a new command comes in to take over, they're having to go back and try to make identifications. And you need to understand that the methodologies at that time were you tried to make identifications according to the dog tags, according to clothing, as long as they had their name and stuff, but it was chaos, it was war, and you didn't necessarily have the ability to identify someone immediately. So they would be buried as an unknown.
There were a huge number of similarities between the circumstances relating to Goron X2 and Goron X3.
Well, X2 was definitely part of the armored car crew, and they were gathered together. And when you look at their files, you can see that they're buried on the same day. They get exhumed to be re-looked at in a similar fashion. One gets identified as an American, and the other suddenly gets categorized as an unknown German. The date, the death, the method of death, the, you know, explosion, death, are close enough, similar enough, that this really gives the team hope that, well, maybe that's what happened.
Since we last spoke, we received the results from the German government regarding the transfer of the body that was located in X3 Goron to the Germans. It turns out that the U.S. had determined that that body may have been German as a result of a scrap of clothing in the grave whenever they dug the grave up later to reprocess it. And at that stage, they decided to transfer it to the Germans.
It became clearer and clearer to the Gordon family in 2013 that their missing uncle was almost certainly found, and that he had been buried by mistake in a German war cemetery in France. But the family knew officially confirming PFC Gordon's identity wasn't going to be easy. So they consulted with a number of experts. One was Dr. Don Simley, a forensic dentist.
My initial assessment of the case was I thought that it was going to be difficult because of the different types of records. When you have just dental charting and no x-rays, it makes for a difficult process. You can come up with some pretty strong consistencies, but to come up with a positive identification is going to be difficult.
I entered the Army in 1962, and I know how haphazard the dental records were at that time. So in the 1940s, who knows who was doing? I mean, I've on a number of occasions had a dental tech rather than the dentist in an Army clinic be the one who filled out the chart. Is this a competent person? And, you know, just these questions that I think some effort should be devoted to answering.
While the past director of the U.S. government's accounting agency felt there was enough evidence to pursue the case further, the current agency didn't agree.
In the U.S. government's case for Gordon, for PFC Lawrence Gordon, there was no desire to exhume. They did not feel that the information provided could possibly be correct. And they were just like, well, in any case, it's under German purview, so we don't have a say in it. Well, that's an easy answer. The reality is they could have reached out to the Volksbund, just the way the research team did. But that wasn't where they felt that they should be doing their work.
There may be arguments you could make that this is not Uncle Lawrence. And it may turn out that it isn't Uncle Lawrence. I think it is, and I'm satisfied from all the evidence that we've got it right. But if it isn't him, giving the U.S. accounting community the benefit of every doubt they've tried to raise, then at least we have closure to the extent that we've done everything we can to find him.
And given how this was handled in the 1940s, I think there is a possibility that this could be him. But we owe the family the effort to prove or disprove that.
The agencies tasked by the U.S. Department of Defense with identifying missing soldiers were contacted about the PFC Gordon case. Despite repeated attempts since October of 2013, they declined to comment on camera or in a written statement.
For some, they weren't identified at the time, and unfortunately my uncle fell into that category, but that's the point. I mean, this idea that you shouldn't try because there might be some sort of a little wrinkle in the case, to me, is asinine. The family would sooner know that you tried and failed than to have you sit there and throw up roadblocks and pretend it didn't happen or that it's an insurmountable task. We have DNA testing. I mean, we put people in jail for life based on DNA testing. And yet the U.S. accounting community seems to think that the idea of taking DNA testing is something where, well, you can't do it unless you can prove beyond a reasonable doubt that that's the person that's in the grave. Well, hang on. The whole purpose of the DNA testing is to, in fact, prove who it is. Now, it's the ultimate catch-22. If you can prove who it is, well, then we'll disinter him and take the DNA testing. Well, hell, if we can prove who it is, we don't need to take the DNA testing. Why is he unidentified in the first place?
We spoke with somebody at an American cemetery over in France, and basically what it came down to is, unless we're 100% certain that we have who we think we have in a unmarked grave site, then they won't allow us to dig over there. We cannot get access unless we're 100% sure. And that's a ridiculous standard.
With no help from the U.S. government, the family of PFC Lawrence S. Gordon, through its own efforts, were able to secure a meeting with the German War Graves Commission, the Volksbund Deutsche Kriegsgräberfürsorge, about the possibility that PFC Gordon's remains were in one of their cemeteries. The meeting was held at the Volksbund's headquarters in Kessel, Germany. Lawrence attended with Alex Meyer, a family friend who acted as a translator. Cameras were not allowed in the meeting.
Alex, that was a great meeting, but I'm not sure what happened because 90% of it was in German. Can you please tell me?
Yeah, well, we did the big talk, and I think you're very happy with the result because the Volksbund will support your cause 100%. I think they can be very helpful, and they've already agreed to DNA testing.
Oh, that's fantastic news.
We'll have to get permission by a French a prosecutor, but as far as I know, this will, you know, can be done very easily. So that's the next step we have to take, and after that, we're good to go. The Volksbund confirmed that the research done is correct, and they believe the body in a grave X4057 to be your uncle.
It's a great feeling, absolutely great. I mean, it's gone farther than I ever thought it would. It's I was happy every step of the way with what I'd learned about the history of my Uncle Lawrence, but to see it come to the conclusion that it looks like it is going to come to is just incredible. It's really beyond a person's wildest dreams.
So why did the Germans believe the evidence was so compelling, but the U.S. Department of Defense didn't? Despite repeated attempts to find out, no one at the Department of Defense, or its new Defense POW/MIA accounting agency, are saying. The only indication is emails obtained through a Freedom of Information Act request. Those emails, from top leadership, blame the Secretary of the Army, saying that this case would never have reached the level required by him. The Gordon family's next step was to get permission from the French government to disinter the remains known as X3.
One right here.
This was necessary because the German cemetery is on French soil.
So at that point, it kind of sped up and the French said, absolutely, we concur with this idea of opening the ossuary and doing DNA testing. And oh, by the way, because this young man, this PFC Gordon, was part of the liberating forces that came in to Normandy, we're going to do that DNA testing for free. And it's the national, the French National Crime Lab who did it. That's a big deal. That's huge. I mean, it's not like they don't have better things to do than test some DNA for some obscure American.
INPS is the equivalent of the FBI in the United States. Frédéric Dupuch is its director.
The case of Private First Class Lawrence Gordon, it's not an unusual case for the Institute. Institute has for aim to fight crime, So we work for prosecutors, for investigators. We are searching for evidences from a lot of traces. Everything has traces that you can find on a crime scene. For Lawrence Gordon, it's not a crime. War is a crime, but it's a legal crime. It's a legal crime. We are working for history. We are working for the link between people of North America and French people. We are working too for the truth, for his mother, who tried during 60 years to know where was his son. So it's really a case for which we are very proud.
After months of waiting, Lawrence Gordon and his brother Sam made the trip to Wigny-sur-Mer, France, for the opening of the tomb. Because the U.S. government declined to be involved in the DNA collection process, the Gordon family asked Dr. Joshua Hyman from the University of Wisconsin to be there.
It hasn't set in fully, I don't think, the impact of today. It's overwhelming and a little bit surreal because we've waited so long for it and now it's coming so quickly. We're within, you know, half an hour of them actually opening up the vault and starting to take DNA material, and we're going to see the remains. We're going to be standing within a few feet of them, and it's more than I ever would have expected I would get to do ever.
Surrounded by French media, Lawrence Gordon finally got to look at the remains that were believed to be his uncle. But before the box was opened, local police asked for all cameras to be turned off, because French laws ban the broadcast of an exhumation.
Well, it's a very emotional feeling whenever you are standing about 6 feet away from the remains of the person that you believe was your uncle, someone that you never met because he died 6 years before I was born, someone that I've only heard about and read about through research and through stories passed down in the family. So it's a feeling that's very hard to put into words.
After removing 7 bone samples from the German cemetery, INPS transferred the material to their DNA lab in Marseille, France. Dr. Alain Stevanovich, a DNA expert, was the lead scientist on the case.
Alain, you're going to be performing all the DNA analysis?
Yeah, we are doing all from the extraction, from DNA extraction, DNA amplification, and DNA sequencing at the end of the analysis.
Dr. Stevanovich took the bones believed to be PFC Gordon and ground them down to create a powder. That powder was then used for DNA analysis.
I think it's a very interesting case because we have a family that waiting for result, and for us it's very important. We are not doing it just for analysis. We are doing it for family. We are doing it to answer them a question that they are waiting result for 70 years. So it's very important to give them this information.
After 70 years, the Gordon family finally had hope. Hope that PFC Gordon might soon be coming home.
When my uncle Lawrence was killed, his mother had written to the U.S. Army. She wanted to find the location of the grave because at that time his younger brother Robert, who had been in the Canadian Scottish, was in Europe and wanted to visit the grave on the way home.
Coleman, Alberta, October 8th, 1946, to the War Department in Washington, D.C. Dear sir, I am writing you in regards to the location of the grave of my son, PFC Lawrence S. Gordon, of the 32nd Armored Regiment, who was killed in action in Normandy on August 13, 1944. I have written you before concerning this and also to the Red Cross, but as yet have failed to get a satisfactory reply. I should think by this time they would have located it. Please let me know at your earliest convenience and oblige. Mrs. Ella Gordon, Coleman, Alberta, Canada.
The response, of course, was that they didn't have a grave and they weren't able to give that information at that time. So my grandmother was extremely bitter about it and, in fact, wouldn't accept the Purple Heart. And that's how my father received it. Whenever it came, she was ready to throw it out. And she was very, very bitter about the lack of information that she received.
American War Department just ignored it. They wouldn't answer nothing to his mother, and she was pretty heartbroken over that.
The resistance that the family received all along, the lack of information, the lack of transparency from the point. And it, you know, you'll probably hear it more times, but the family back in at the time of loss, he was dead. He was missing in action. He was buried with honors. He wasn't buried. I mean, there's this whole litany of messages that the mother receives of her son that is just confusing. And then to carry that forward into today and to still be receiving that same kind of confusion and resistance and lack of communication and lack of transparency. As an American citizen, I'm very disappointed. As a former DPMO worker, you know, part of the system, I'm sad. I'm just sad because I know that the historians and the archivists and all the people who are working and believe in this mission are being constrained by a flawed system.
The inability to find my uncle's grave left my grandmother thinking the body had been lost. The problem was the wallet. The wallet came home with no identification in it. So they knew that the wallet had belonged to Lawrence S. Gordon. They knew where his family was. They got it back to the right family. It was the right wallet. But there was no body. And they couldn't give a location, a grave site, any information to my grandmother. So her conclusion was that something wasn't right. The body had been lost, misplaced, whatever. It just doesn't make sense that you have a wallet that is in reasonable condition and there's no body left.
After decades without answers, the Gordon family, living in Canada, had very little faith in the American accounting agencies and their mottos claiming no one left behind.
The American experience hasn't been a pleasant one.
Currently, there are over 83,000 missing U.S. soldiers from past wars, World War II to the present. According to a 2014 report issued by the U.S. government's Cost Assessment and Program Evaluation Office, the U.S. Department of Defense spends about $190 million annually to account for missing personnel from past conflicts. That same report says, on average, that the U.S. government only identifies about 74 soldiers per year. That means it's costing about $2.5 million per identification. Making things worse, the Gordon family says the U.S. government's treatment has made this a negative experience.
You can't delay and frustrate people to the point where many of them go away. If I wasn't an attorney, I may very well have given up. I had given up in 2000 when I was told that there were essentially no records. I felt like, well, I might as well pack my bag and go home. And if it wasn't for independent researchers who sought me out and contacted me, I never would have had a renewed interest. I never would have had the information. So the process that is in place, that's been established by the U.S. military, needs to be reviewed. It needs to be revamped.
The concept of whether or not the Gordon family realistically should be angry at the government is a complex question. And I won't answer it from my previous position per se, but using the experience that I had, I think that it is justified. I think that if the government of the United States is going to mouth or say that this is the most honorable and most important mission and that the fullest accounting, fullest possible, and that's a key, fullest possible recovery for the families, and that the families, if you will, are our clients, if that's what we're going to say, you know, if that's our marketing tagline or our motto, then we have an absolute obligation to be doing that, to be fulfilling that obligation.
We leave no one behind, and we have a pledge to our military to bring them back home. So it's for our military that gave their lives and for their families. We owe it to their families to bring them back home, if at all possible.
The numbers are staggering. Why do we keep searching? The answer is simple. You don't leave a fallen American behind. The families deserve an answer.
I expected the Americans to be on side completely. And I was, in retrospect, I was naive. I thought We're all on the same page. We're trying to do the same thing. The goal is to find a soldier who was killed in action, who was never recovered. And to me, it just seemed like it's common sense that everyone would want to find him, identify him, bring him home. That's not what we got, as far as I'm concerned.
Even worse for the Gordon family. In an April 1st, 2013 memo, the Joint POW-MIA Accounting Command, or JPAC, which had overall jurisdiction in this case, said, quote, "It should be noted that PFC Gordon was a Canadian citizen serving in the U.S. Army, and it is unclear what is JPAC's authority or responsibility in such matters."
It's like a battle, and it's frustrating because they're supposed to be doing what we're trying to do, namely find a lost American soldier, someone who lost his life fighting for them. And even though he was a Canadian, he chose to fight with the American military. He lost his life in the process, and it would just, common sense says to me that you would do everything you can to help people find the remains of this soldier. And that isn't what you get from the American system. My opinion of the U.S. accounting system has gone way down. I mean, I think that they're an embarrassment to the American taxpayer. And if I was in the United States paying taxes, I would be demanding of my congressman some explanation as to why I'm paying taxes to fund an organization that is bordering on incompetent, in my opinion.
One congresswoman you won't have to complain to is Senator Claire McCaskill from Missouri.
We get daily complaints about the dysfunction at JPAC. I have never seen a more inexcusable turf war in my life than the turf war that has gone on within this important responsibility within the military. And here's the problem we have right now. And by the way, you know how long we've been talking about this? Decades. For decades, we have been talking about this. It's embarrassing if you go back and read GAO, old GAO reports and old committee hearings on this subject, how long this problem has been identified and not fixed.
In fact, things got so bad that the national media began reporting on scandals.
83,000 American troops are missing in wars from Vietnam to Afghanistan. Today, the Secretary of Defense announced a reorganization of the agency that's supposed to identify them. The Joint POW-MIA Accounting Command, or JPAC, was the subject of a CBS News investigation that reported on mismanagement there.
This effort is not just a top priority for the Department of Defense. It's our responsibility and our obligation.
You should always do the right thing for the families of the missing. But in this case, there were so many opportunities for the government to collaborate with, to work. They have been mouthing the propaganda that they want to work with independent, you know, researchers, historians, more transparent collaboration with public, if you will, private citizens. And yet the very moment that probably the best public relations case can have come into existence, they fought it the whole way. They fought it every step of the way.
In January of 2014, the deputy commander of the Joint POW-MIA Accounting Command, which was in charge of the identification of missing service members, said, "As you know, both our scientists and historians believe that neither the forensic nor the historical evidence is sufficient to validate the interred remains being PFC Lawrence Gordon." 3 weeks later, Lawrence Gordon was informed by the French that the DNA samples taken from the German cemetery matched the DNA samples provided by him and his cousins.
I was in my office whenever the final news came, and it was just a great feeling. I was satisfied when I had seen the lower jaw in September that we had the right person. So when we received the DNA testing, well, it was just a great feeling of success.
The U.S. Department of Defense was then notified that France's National Crime Lab had found a DNA match to PFC Gordon's nephews. A month later, the Gordon family was informed that the director of the Defense Prisoner of War Missing Personnel Office, or DPMO, felt that the results were not good enough. Meanwhile, as part of an agreement with the French, bone powder and a tooth were given to Dr. Joshua Hyman at the University of Wisconsin's DNA sequencing facility. In collaboration with Bode Technology, they set out to confirm the French's results.
The Wisconsin idea is that the university is founded to help people in this state. Our job is to make lives better, to make sure that people in Wisconsin and people all over the world end up being a little better off every single day because of the work we do.
In May of 2014, the University of Wisconsin was able to confirm the results provided by France's National Crime Lab. Ed Huffine worked for Bode Technology during the Gordon case and has assisted in identifying more than 10,000 human remains from all over the world. Huffine says, now with the advancement of DNA technology, especially nuclear DNA, there is hope for other families who want to identify recovered remains.
Nuclear DNA testing offers a possibility to identify thousands of missing U.S. soldiers. It has already identified thousands of civilians in other countries.
Bode Technology, where Huffine used to work, was the third lab to collaborate on the PFC Gordon case, and it only took them 8 days to complete the DNA testing.
We're able to get the DNA profiles from the nephews, compare them to the nuclear DNA profile from the PFC Gordon remains, and we're able to then do a statistical calculation of probability. When all the data was combined, the DNA data, it was 99.995%.
I mean, that's in the DNA world, that's a home run. That's it. You know, you've got it. At which point, you know, DPMO, the leadership there, the director there is kind of backed into a corner, I think. And that's personal opinion. I can't prove that. But I think that he basically had to agree to the identification. Appropriately so. But still, disappointing that they didn't accept the National Crime Lab of France DNA results. That would be like if America had done a testing with the FBI crime lab and France said, oh yeah, not good enough.
After reviewing the DNA evidence provided by the University of Wisconsin and Bode Technology, on May 27, 2014, without any scientist from the US government ever having seen the remains or participating in any of the testing, Private First Class Lawrence S. Gordon was officially considered accounted for by the U.S. Department of Defense. For DNA experts, the PFC Gordon case demonstrated the power of a DNA-led system and its ability to identify a significant number of the 10,000 sets of unknown remains that lie in unmarked graves in U.S. cemeteries around the world.
If a nuclear DNA-led system was instituted as a routine basis for testing, it is my professional opinion the majority of U.S. soldiers' remains that are found today would be able to be identified.
Even where we're at right now, we don't need to progress and move forward with our technology to be able to identify many of the unknowns that are out in the field right now. We have the technology now. We just have to apply it.
The question that many have is, why isn't the U.S. government applying this technology? After waiting his whole life to honor the commitment he made to his father, it was finally time for Lawrence to bring his uncle's remains home.
The thing I'm looking forward to the most in France are two things. I'm really looking forward to having the U.S. Military place the rosette by his name at the Brittany American Cemetery. And I'm obviously looking forward to the moment whenever the remains are officially turned over to me by the Volksbund. That's what this has been all about. It'll just be a great feeling of accomplishment at that moment to know that Uncle Lawrence is no longer in a missing in action soldier.
One day before the Germans relinquished the remains of PFC Gordon into his namesake's hands, the American Battlefields Monuments Commission, or ABMC, authorized the placing of a rosette next to PFC Gordon's name on the wall of the missing at Brittany American Cemetery. A rosette is placed next to the name of a soldier on the wall of the missing who is identified.
The significance of the rosette to me is that it's symbolic. It's letting anyone know that comes in here that he's been identified. And I feel strongly that that's, you know, something that I want people to know when they come here, whether I come back and see it, or relatives of mine come here and see it, or just complete strangers. I want them to know that there is hope. Let's just take this down. It's time. There it is. I was naive. I thought that the U.S. military wanted to find their lost or fallen soldiers. I don't think that anymore. The best stroke of luck we had was that his remains were turned over to the Germans. If they had been in this cemetery in an unmarked grave, he still wouldn't be identified. And I just think that's tragic.
Because we send people off to war. We take someone's brother or son or uncle or father and we send him off to war. We owe him the honor of returning him to his native soil if he's paid the supreme sacrifice. And we owe his family something for their loss. I mean, it's what this country is supposed to be all about.
In June of 2014, the Germans arranged a small ceremony to transfer the remains of PFC Gordon from their stewardship to that of his nephew.
So thankful for the help that we've gotten. It's tremendous.
It's an honor. I think it's an honor to bring a fallen comrade and a member of the family home. So
it sure is.
There's no importance whether which country he's from, but the most important thing is to bring him back.
Present arm.
I signed the paperwork this morning so that officially Uncle Lawrence is in my stewardship. We're going to the Charles de Gaulle Airport. He'll be flown back to Madison, Wisconsin, where the forensic anthropologist and forensic odontologist will examine the remains.
But before leaving France, PFC Gordon would get one final honor from the French Air Force.
Ha ha ha!
it's been quite a ride so far. We're just approaching O'Hare, where they're going to remove the coffin and Uncle Lawrence's remains from the plane.
After arriving at O'Hare Airport in Chicago, PFC Gordon's remains were driven to Madison, Wisconsin, with a police escort and Patriot Guard riders protecting his flanks the whole way. After arriving to a hero's welcome at the University of Wisconsin Hospital, PFC Gordon's remains were turned over to forensic anthropologist Dr. Leslie Eisenberg and forensic odontologist Dr. Donald Simley. Again, the U.S. Department of Defense declined to participate.
Basically, anthropology in this case was a confirmation of the results of the DNA analysis. It's always better to have a team approach to human identification. And in this case, not only were there multiple players involved in getting to the same outcome, but there was also a family involved who was so invested in getting answers, whatever those answers might be. In this case, through DNA and anthropology, the remains were positively confirmed as those of Private Gordon.
A few days shy of the 70th anniversary of his death, it was finally time for PFC Gordon to begin the last leg of his journey home.
I think about my father today. I also think about my two uncles, because the four brothers were very, very close. And I think about my father more, obviously, because he's the one that passed on the stories to me about Uncle Lawrence, and he's the one that I gave a commitment to.
The Gordon family elected to drive PFC Gordon home to Canada. Starting in Wisconsin, they wanted to go through Casper, Wyoming, the soldier's last home, before enlisting in the U.S. Army.
It's an amazing experience to go through Casper. They treat him like he's one of their homegrown boys. It was an incredible display, very, very moving and touching.
Unfortunately, the stop in Casper disqualified PFC Gordon from receiving a military escort. After hearing the news, Navy Commander Rene Richardson decided to be PFC Gordon's symbolic escort.
The singular thing and the singular completion of an action that I am most proud of and means everything to me is bringing PFC Lawrence Gordon home. It's as if the universe reached out and allowed me to do one thing in my career that actually means something. You know, pushing papers and whatever, analysis, those things were interesting and fun, but they did not carry the human significance and the human weight in my heart that being a part of this this journey means to me. This is the best thing I've done for the military.
After driving more than 1,600 miles, PFC Gordon finally arrived back on his native soil.
We're leaving in a few minutes to go to East End. We have the equivalent of the Patriot Guard, the 3rd Cav here in Canada that's escorting us. The motorcycles are lining up. There's going to be a police escort through the city. The RCMP are going to take over as soon as we leave the jurisdiction of the city police, and they're going to escort us all the way to East End. Whenever we get just outside of East End, we're going to be met by 47 motorcycles from Run for the Wall. They're going to fall in side by side with the Canadian motorcyclists and lead us into East End where the funeral and the interment will take place.
Guard, to the fallen, present arm!
Forward, march!
Today, 70 years after the death of Private First Class Lawrence Samuel Gordon, the extension of his family begins appropriate closure. But unlike other deaths, four nations begin that journey of closure as well. We, the Canadians, reaching out from this community, from where he was born, and from where his extended family spread, the Americans with whom he shared dual citizenship, and under whose flag he offered his life, the French upon whose soil he died and for whose liberation he fought, and the Germans to whom his remains were given and in a German ossuary where his remains have found temporary home these last seven decades. That so many people have worked committedly to see that this unknown soldier might not remain unknown for all time is a gift to all who wonder about the lost wherever they have fallen. In this sacred moment is the realized hope of a family and the promise that families throughout the world need not abandon hope of having their loved ones return to them.
Say that birds can detect a storm when it's just coming under. It's like some sense we can never know, some instinct sure wonder. But I think I felt it then, when I felt that way back when. It shook me down to the holy ground like prairie thunder. An earth once black swivels into green. It's another worldly scene. From the darkness a spark is thrown. Heaven knows where it's going. Sends my spirit on the run, heading for that hot red sun. The combines thrum the hoppers on like prairie thunder. And they say that birds can detect a storm when it's just coming under. It's like some sense we can never know, some instinctual wonder. but I think I'll feel it now. Though I really don't know how. Shakes me down to the holy ground. Like prairie thunder. Road home, I have never been alone. Shadows were falling, but voices were calling. Peace be with you, one and all. Yes, yeah, I've never been alone. Though it's been a long road home, take me down to the holy ground and lay me under. My prairie thunder, my prairie thunder.
To go over to Europe and fight and die for us, I mean, to bring him home is the least that we can do.
PFC Gordon was no longer able to fight for himself. It took other people to fight for him, to bring him home.
And there's a certain feeling of, you know, satisfaction that something that was wrong that happened 70 years ago is now being corrected.
That it matters to me because I had said to my father that I was going to visit Uncle Lawrence's grave and there wasn't one. So you can let it go if you wish. You can just drop it. You can forget about it. But if you forget about it, then to my mind, you forget some of the lessons of history. And I think that that would be a terrible way to treat the commitment that was made by those people that have died during a war.
Some kind of joke for a man in this cold world to hold on.